An excerpt from My Brother's Daughter, a Chronicles of Warfare novel, Book 9, by Melinda Michelle. Narrated by Autumn Woods. Copyright 2018. Chapter 1. Frenemies. For the time being, all was quiet in the Lawson home. There had been no spiritual drama or emergencies looming over their heads. Neil was at work, while Gray decided to catch a much-needed nap now that her baby boy had finally decided to take his. Gray lay on the plush sofa, knocked out with a book on her chest, as Barrington Scottsdale, the feline she loved to hate, sat curled up at her feet, getting in his afternoon nap as well. The baby monitor was right next to her head. Hunter was in his crib, which is why Barry was in the living room. Still jealous of the new addition to their family, he avoided Hunter like the plague and made no qualms about letting them know he didn't like their little bundle of joy. It tickled Gray to no end. Neil was ready to evict him the first time his jealousy got out of control. The tan fur on Barry's chubby body began to stand up on end. His low purring stopped as he opened one of his green eyes. Something wasn't right. Both eyes open now. The cat stood up to see what was amiss. He looked up at the two angels that guarded Gray, Savas and Bohan. He knew them, but they wouldn't create this feeling of evil. Apprehensive, Barry watched as the angels glorified. They drew their weapons as their eyes and artillery lit up with blue flames. Barry sat back on his haunches and watched as they headed outside the house. He stared, waiting to see what was about to unfold. Outside, and invisible to the human eye, Insidious casually strolled to the edge of their yard, careful not to cross the threshold. He was ancient, a menacing demon that stood 7 feet tall. His frame was long and lean. His skin was smoke gray and reptilian. His long tail had a darted tip that would whip out and snatch you in a heartbeat. His face was that of a canine. His black eyes held a mysterious glow. His fanged teeth glinted in the sunlight. Righteous indignation flooded Gray's warriors as they could not believe the audacity of this vile creature.
"State your cause or see the pit this day,"
Savas, a Turkish warrior, said with conviction as his two broadswords flamed at his sides. Insidious grinned. He raised both of his oyster-colored clawed palms in a sign of surrender. "My brother, I come in peace. If you know nothing about me, you know I respect protocol. I'm more civilized than that. Besides, I'm alone. Why would I engage the four of you without backup?" Savas's eyes narrowed.
"You stopped being my brother when you chose to follow Lucifer and his plot against Father."
In his smooth, silky voice, Insidious responded.
"That was eons ago. Surely we're past that, brother. Let's move on, shall we?"
Bohan, a Serbian warrior, was over it. He demanded,
"State your cause now."
Insidious chuckled.
"I'm here to see him, of course."
Bohan's long sword flamed even more as he took a step towards Insidious.
"I see insanity has captured you in your old age."
"Careful, brother,"
Insidious said in a warning tone without flinching.
"I didn't come here to start a war. Now, I could alert his mother to my presence, but we all know that's not wise. If she detects my level of power, all sorts of bells and whistles will go off in her spirit."
Bohan and Savas glanced at each other. Insidious continued.
"If she's alerted to my presence and feels that I am a threat to her son, surely she will go into warrior mode. Neither of us wants that. We know she's more dangerous than his father could ever be, which is why her womb was chosen to carry him.
I want no part of an unnecessary war with that seer."
Again, Savas and Bohan looked at each other knowingly.
"Furthermore, if she's concerned with the safety of her son, even though he's behind a hedge, she won't be able to focus on protecting her niece. She's her watchman. We all know Nigel's daughter is the only reason I'm in this abysmal region in the first place. Let's try and stay focused, shall we?
Brother? Savas and Bohan eyed each other again. They knew Insidious was 100% correct. Gray would lose it. Her love for her son would unleash everything inside of her that was capable of protecting him. Even she didn't know just how powerful she was. It wasn't yet the time to reveal it. Savas asked, Why?
Why else? I'm curious. He has been talked about for decades. I just want to lay my eyes on this promised child. You know I've always had an appreciation for father's work, especially the uniquely gifted ones. Rest assured, I will alert her to my presence and make her believe I am a threat to her child if you deny me the chance to satisfy my curiosity.
Curiosity? That would be laughable if you weren't so dangerous, Bohan snapped. I'm curious to know why you care, seeing as how you and your cowardly comrades tried to take him out.
I did no such thing. They did. You know I don't insert myself in the promises of God. It's a frivolous fight for which I don't have time. I excel at what I do because I'm not greedy, nor do I let my ego dictate my actions.
Again, Savas and Bohan looked at each other. Insidious was indeed a different type of demon. He never tried to work outside the will of God, but his subtle manipulations within the boundaries set by God and his permissive will were legendary in the spirit realm. They considered their options. Savas reluctantly said,
We will allow it this one time. You cannot touch him, and we will shield your presence from his mother. Those are the conditions. Accept it or walk away.
Insidious nodded. Bohan warned,
If this is a trick of any kind, we have no problem inciting this war and taking you out to protect this charge.
You have my word, brothers, Insidious said with sincerity.
He took two steps onto their property. The light responded. Hunter's two naval warriors, Alvise and Ranj, arrived first, along with Captain Valter, Lieutenant Nero, and the Angel of Death in all his black diamond beauty. They stood between the house and Insidious, weapons drawn and eyes aflame.
What is the meaning of this breach?
The Scandinavian captain's voice demanded with a boom. Insidious smiled.
Well, if it isn't my favorite captain of the hosts.
Valter had his blue-flamed saber to Insidious's throat in an instant.
I'm not playing games with you.
Insidious didn't flinch, because he knew the captain wouldn't strike without sufficient cause. He did eye Nero carefully, though, because he just might.
As I told Savas and Bohan, I'm curious about the promised child, and I want to meet him. I mean him no harm. We all know he isn't the reason I'm here. I do not have permission to attack him, and you know that I do not step outside of the boundaries set by Father.
One of Death's golden chains shot out and yoked Insidious by the throat. The move caught everyone by surprise, especially Insidious, as he had never known Death to engage in warfare. Death lifted him off the ground.
No! Savas screamed. Your glorified presence will alert Gray!
Death immediately dropped him as they all turned to see Gray stirring in her sleep and Barry climbing down off the sofa heading towards the front door. Insidious coughed as he rubbed his clawed hand over his throat.
I see I've missed a lot since I've been to this region.
No one responded as he got up and dusted himself off.
As I said, I am only here out of sheer curiosity. When I chose to follow our brother Lucifer, I gave up many privileges. I'm simply asking for this dispensation, brother. His mother is still stirring. Let's not move her focus from where it needs to be.
Captain Valter turned to face Savas and Bohan. Before he could give instructions, Death walked up to the captain and touched his temple to share something only he knew. The information caused Captain Valter's eyes to deflame and stare at the Angel of Death wide-eyed. Death whispered to the captain, Sometimes we must pick our battles in order to ensure we win the war. He's right. We don't want to stir the warrior in gray or remove her focus from the assignment the Almighty has given her. There is a reason she was chosen to be the watchman for Nigel's firstborn. Only she can see the truth behind this war and fight accordingly. Valter nodded. He looked at his comrades and said,
Escort him to the child.
The angels obeyed their captain's order without hesitation, but they were interested as to what changed his mind. Insidious was gracious because he knew this was indeed a privilege. All the spiritual beings walked into the house. Barry had a full-on fit when Insidious came through the door. The Angel of Death cast his shadow over Gray to keep her from detecting this demon in her home. They walked to the nursery where Hunter was still sleeping peacefully. Barrington was fit to be tied. He hissed at Insidious. The demon spared him one glance and a chuckle.
"That's cute," he said as he headed to the baby's room.
There was a blue light all around the baby boy. Every angel stood around him with their weapons drawn, just in case Insidious tried to pull a fast one. Since they all had something to lose, they decided the risk was enough to make everyone involved trustworthy. For the moment. Insidious looked down at the sleeping, chubby chocolate bundle.
"Wow," he said. "This is really something."
All the angels, save for Death, smiled despite the situation. He was indeed a special child.
"So, he's a shield. Even as a baby, he's already activated,"
Insidious said with genuine reverence in his voice. Valter nodded.
"Yes."
Death asked Insidious,
"Does it make you regret your choice to serve darkness?"
Insidious sighed.
"Regret is too much of a burden to bear for as long as I have lived. I accept my fate, but that doesn't mean I can't wreak havoc while I'm here. And I plan to be around until the bitter end. My brothers, I bid you adieu. Thank you for the opportunity. We can go back to despising each other now."
With that, Insidious walked out. Even though his words were sincere, his motives were not. He wanted to know just how special Hunter was to try and gauge what Nigel's child could possibly possess beyond what they had already heard. They thought Neil was the only shield that existed, but clearly the light was up to something. Now there were two, and they weren't trying to keep it a secret. That was indeed very interesting. He couldn't calculate his next move without this information. He was grateful his brethren were more wise than ferocious. Using Gray as a bargaining chip was the perfect manipulation to get what he truly wanted. Insight. Death's shadow was still covering Gray as Insidious made his exit. In the baby's room, they all looked at each other. Nero, an Italian warrior, began.
"Captain." Valter shook his head. "My reasons will remain hidden until the truth is revealed. Believe me, when it is, you'll understand my decision. Come, we must go and plan for Insidious's attack. He's going to come for Nigel's daughter with everything he's got. Insidious is a formidable adversary, and the most strategic demon I know. His decision to come here was a calculated risk, one he deemed worth the price he may have to pay. This bold move was more than what he alluded it to be. That I am confident of."
They all nodded as Death, Nero, and Valter took off in a tangle of white and navy blue splendor. When Death's shadow lifted, Gray heard Barrington hissing. She got up, trying to figure out what was going on. She hoped some rodent, or worse, a snake, hadn't gotten into the house. When she got to the baby's room, she was flabbergasted. There was the fat, tan cat marching back and forth in front of Hunter's crib with the meanest look she'd ever seen on his face. She understood by his demeanor he was being protective of her son.
"What in the world has gotten into you, Barry?" she inquired, chuckling.
The cat relaxed when he saw Gray and sat on his haunches at full alert. He didn't like the baby, but no evil was going to just walk in and mess with him either. Gray and Neil would never understand what gave Barry a change of heart, but he had officially just assigned himself as Hunter's guardian.